Did you smell that? Yeah? Did you recognize it? Or was it a little bit too long ago since you smelled the smell of money? Paper money. Yeah, that's right. Pecunia non olet, the Romans would say. Money doesn't stink. But it has a smell. It had a smell. In the old days, money was made of copper, silver, or gold. And in the Middle Ages, the Europeans introduced paper money. Now imagine that transition from solid metal you could weigh, hold, test between your teeth, to the volatile papery promises without much weight to them. Well, banknotes, bonds, and stocks didn't have much weight, but they could acquire boundless value. One thing hadn't changed, though. You could still hold it, smell it, put it in your pocket, hide it under your mattress. So money was all around. And look at us now. In a world of finance where we use bank apps, bitcoins, cryptos, in a world where money nearly has lost all its touch and smell, in a world where less and less people use cash. Is that a bad thing? Not necessarily, but I think it's a sign of a bigger issue. We are not only out of touch with money, we are out of touch with the world of finance altogether. When is the last time you entered a bank? Who has a clue as to what is going on behind these mirrored windows of the skyscrapers of trade firms? Who of us really understood the last series of financial crises that made people lose their jobs, their homes? The world of finance dominates our society, but we seem to have no clue as to what it is about. We do not understand the numbers, and we cannot really see or feel what is going on. Thus, we pretend to forget all about it. And that is also why financial crisis hit us with surprise, time and time again. And this is also visible from the images that were made to visualize the last financial crisis in 2008, because this is what we saw. Storms and floods, typhoons, meltdowns, the world on fire. A financial crisis is a natural disaster, a tempest raging over us, uncontrollable, unpredictable, unfathomable. And the images are often impersonal, clinical. The world of finance doesn't seem to be managed by people. And when people are depicted, they are shown like this: at a loss, apathic, dejected. In this world, machines do all the talking in code, code that is not meant for human eyes. This world is dehumanized. Money is no longer a public affair. Now, what a difference with the past. Finance used to be such a lively, engaging spectacle, an engaging experience, full of human activity and emotion, center stage in the public arena. And I would like to take you there. Follow me to the place where our modern financial system was developed. Well, we don't have to walk very far, because it was in this very city that the first shares were issued. Stock trading was invented in Amsterdam, in the Golden Age. Well, the main location for this trade was on the Rokin, in the center of Amsterdam. There stood one of the most famous buildings of the whole world, the Amsterdam Stock Exchange. And when this magnificent building opened its doors in 1611, it immediately became one of the busiest places of Amsterdam, swarming with merchants, international merchants, with citizens from Amsterdam, and with tourists from all over the world. Because it was an open building. you could freely enter it, climb the stairs to the first floor, and then overlook the trade arena. What did these people experience? Now, although the building is no longer there, we can sort of relive this experience right here in this theater, right now. Because to give you a sense of place, we have made 3D representations of the building. And Jorg has designed the scent of the Amsterdam Stock Exchange. And this is the premiere. You're going to smell it for the very, very first time. So make use of all your senses and take a trip down memory lane with us, back to the 17th century, back to the steps of the Amsterdam Stock Exchange. Okay, here we go. Can you smell it? Good. Do you see? It's an open market here. Huh? So there's no roof over the trade floor, and the gates to the exchange are open. And maybe you smell the air. And maybe you also smell a bit of stinky water. Well, that's the River Amstel, because the Bourse was built over the River Amstel, so boats could float underneath it. And these boats were used to supply the shops in and around the building. Because this was also one of the first shopping malls of Europe. And on the first floor, tourists could buy and citizens could buy paintings, clocks, carpets, jewels, all kinds of luxury products from all over the world. Now imagine that trade floor being crowded with hundreds of merchants. And maybe you smell a bit of their musky bodies. And did anyone smell exotic spice? Yeah. Well, that makes sense too, because these merchants just have come back from the Amsterdam harbor, the warehouses there, where they have inspected the goods and some of the spices still on their coats. And there in the corner, you can see the stock traders crowding together like a beehive. And they're selling and buying shares and derivatives. And so maybe you also recognize a bit of the paper money odor that we smelled before. Now, people in the Golden Age were fascinated by this modern economy. They wrote about it. I think I have already now collected hundreds of Bourse depictions. And all these engravings and paintings invite you to take part in this very lively spectacle. And they depict the Bourse as the pounding heart of Amsterdam, as a vital organ of society, full of human activity and emotions. And then, 1720, the very first international financial crisis hit the European markets, in Paris, in London, and in Amsterdam. And it was called, do you know it? 1720 crisis? South Sea Bubble, yes. But in the Netherlands, we called it the Windhandel van 1720. When this happened, people did not turn their heads away. No, the speculative bubble was accompanied by a cultural bubble. An explosion of poems, satires, and cartoons that all try to make sense of this speculation, of this folly of speculation, as they called it, or the madhouse of stock jobbers. And people even wrote plays about it, and the Amsterdam Theater would stage these plays. And these plays were meant to help people understand the complex world of shares and derivatives trading. And they did so by depicting the stock market as a household, something everyone could relate to. Now, in this typically Dutch household, a once reliable father becomes mesmerized by speculation. And all of a sudden, this orderly bourgeois home is invaded by stock jobbers who all try to take advantage of this naive merchant. And he even tries to sell his daughter into marrying one of these stock jobbers. But when it comes to love and finance, women are far more sane than men. And this girl, of course, she knows that this stockjobber marriage promises are solely informed by greed and by unfounded hopes of fortune. So, in the end, she's able to unmask the stockjobber and to safeguard the family fortune. And as a reward, she may marry her true lover, a reliable trader. And then the moral of the play reads, "Oh, speculation, you work miracles, all right, for one man loses and another wins his bride." Ah. Okay, nice. Maybe you say, yeah, well, get it. Amsterdam is the cradle of the stock market, and people wrote plays about it, made paintings. So what? Who cares? Well, my answer would be, you should. We all should. I think we can learn two important lessons from this early phase of capitalism. And the first thing is that markets are emotional economies. Now, we have been raised with the idea that markets are efficient and rational. They are not. And the last crisis, again, made us realize that, helped us realize that. The concept of the homo economicus, profit-oriented, self-interested, rational man operating in an always efficient market, is seriously flawed, to say the least. And behind every computer, there's a person writing code, a person with feelings, a person making decisions, decisions with high impact. And if we start to think about finance that way, we can also reconnect to the emotional economies of finance today. And that is my second point. Trade once was a public spectacle, an integral part of society, of our household. And people would write about it, mock it, live it. They were, you could say, in touch with finance, connected. So when the 1720 crisis came, they did not see that as a natural disaster. They didn't expect the market to be rational or efficient. They perceived it in terms of human emotions and activities, by telling stories, by writing plays, by designing monuments for the wild year of 1720. This year, it is 10 years ago since Lehman Brothers collapsed. And they only left me with this silly t-shirt. And some experts say that we're already in the run-up for a new crisis, maybe in 2020. Well, 2020 also happens to be the 300-year anniversary of the South Sea Bubble. We can easily relive the emotions and smells of 1720. We just did. But what about 2008? The memory seems to already and to be fading away. Our economists and politicians seem to be okay with that. They suffer from short-termism. And they like to keep life simple and remembrance short. Why? Because it gives them moral flex. Because if you do not look back, you can always pretend you did not know what was coming. And if you pretend that finance is a sector separate from society, you do not have to take the blame for the economic and social turmoil caused by financial crisis. And then a financial crisis remains a natural disaster, a tempest raging over us, uncontrollable, unpredictable, unfathomable. Well, I think we should stop this by doing what our forefathers did, by designing monuments for financial crisis. And they may be modern monuments, digital, make holograms. Visit trade floors and demand the Zuidas to open its doors for the public. Let bloggers and vloggers capture the emotions of the trade floor. Lest we forget, let again make sense of finance. And senses are very powerful, smell particularly. One of the great things about smell is that it has a strong connection to memory and to place. You have just smelled the scent of the Amsterdam Stock Exchange. You now all have an olfactory memory of a place that you never visited before. It has become part of your life, of you. So, do you want to be surprised by the next financial crisis? No. Then you better be sure to make, again, sense of finance by getting in touch with it, by putting it center stage in the public arena. Listen to its heartbeat, smell its smell. Thank you.